Welcome to the auditorium, guys. We've got a great breakfast history program for you. And I got a challenge to extend to you. Seventh grade came first, and they were phenomenal guests, right? So I challenge you to see if you can do it even better whenever we present this second time, all right? So I'm delighted to welcome you to our Black History Program, a celebration of the rich tapestry of the African-American history and its profound impact on the arts. This year, as we dive into the theme of African-Americans and the arts, we honor the creativity, resilience, and contributions of African-Americans who left an incredible mark on the world through their artistic endeavors. Our program promises to be an enlightening journey, weaving together the threads of history and artistry. We will explore the lives of remarkable individuals whose talents have not only spread and shaped our cultural landscape, but have also paved the way for future generations. To kick off our program, our talented orchestra, led by Ms. Atkins, is going to perform a song titled The African Blessing. We'll then embark in a literary exploration with Kieja Wofford Johnson as she reads about the incomparable Clara Smith, an influential blues singer whose voice echoed through the corridors of history. Next, we'll have Malachi Debnam Dogan. He will take the stage introducing our remarkable Mr. Cameron Pratt. Next, Tamaya Williams will guide us through a passage dedicated to the soulful Etta James, a trailblazer in the world of rhythm and blues. Following this, we'll welcome our second guest speaker, C.J. Davison, who will be introduced by our very own Alicia Barron. He will present and offer a unique perspective on the theme. The program will continue with a passage honoring the legendary P.B.O. Bryson, read by our very own Davion Anderson. Following this performance, our chorus, under the direction of Mr. Lewis, will take the center stage, presenting the powerful renditions of I Know Where I've Been. Following this performance, Still I Rise will be performed by Aria Jones and Riley Feld. Thank you again for joining us on this enlightening presentation. So without no further ado, let the celebration begin.
She died February 2nd, 1935. Clara Smith was born in Spartanburg County, South Carolina. In her youth, she worked on an African-American theater circuit and temp shows. By the late 1910, she was appearing as a headliner at the Lyric Theater in New Orleans. And on the TOBA circuit in 1923, she settled in New York City, appearing at cabarets and speakeasies there. That same year, she made the first of her commercially successful series of gramophone recordings for Columbia Records, for whom she would continue recording through 1932. In 1933, she moved to Detroit, Michigan, and worked at theaters there until her hospitalization in early 1935 for heart disease, of which she died.
Ladies and gentlemen, as esteemed guests, it is with great pleasure that I introduce our distinguished speaker for today, a remarkable individual whose journey has been marked by dedication, athleticism, and commitment to education. Coming from the vibrant city of Columbia, South Carolina, our speaker ventured to the upstate area to pursue a higher education at USC Upstate. During their college years, they showcased their talent as a hurdler, representing the USC Upstate men's track team with distinction. Embarking on a career in education, our speaker has devoted 6 years to shaping young minds. Their initial teaching position at Chapman High School saw them imparting knowledge in the field of social studies, not just confined to the classroom. They took a role of head cross-country coach and soccer coach, exemplifying a passion for both academics and athletics. The journey continued to evolve as our speaker transitioned to his administration, assuming the role of an assistant principal at Berea Middle School. Today, they stand before us as the assistant principal of Easley High School, bringing a wealth experience of insight and genuine commitment to the growth and development of every student. Please join me in the welcoming a true champion of education, an inspiring leader, and a testament to the power of perseverance, our esteemed speaker, Mr. Karen Pratt.
Good afternoon, how's everybody doing? No, it didn't sound so good. How's everybody doing?
Good.
All right, I have to give it to this grade level. That welcome, that opening, the applause and everything was much better than your seventh grade counterpart, so you're already on the good foot. But anyways, I want to introduce myself. I'm Cameron Brett. I'm the assistant principal at Easley High School, and I want to start by thanking Dr. Hall and Mr. Nelson for inviting me to speak with you guys today. I also want to thank you guys, you know, as an audience, as a student body, for taking time out of y'all's day to listen to us speak. Listen to the music performances of your classmates. So I want to thank you guys for that. When Dr. Hall invited me to speak with you guys, I was excited because not only did I get to hear the musical selections and the art from some of your classmates, but I also got the opportunity to meet and look at some of the students from Geddes Middle School before they get to us at Easley High School. One thing that is cool about how our system is set up here at Higgins County, particularly Easley and Geddes Middle School, that is close and in proximity and close in a way that we are training you guys up to be when it comes to graduation. I'm excited to be here also because, like they said, I was the principal of Berea Middle School last year. So middle school has a special place in my heart. Some of you guys may know some from Berea Middle School. Some of y'all may have went there. I've seen some familiar faces come in this auditorium today. So again, it feels good to be back in the middle school. But what I'm here for today is to speak with you guys about African American history and maybe share some of my own experiences. Because when I was thinking about what I was going to speak about today, I struggled a little bit because I wasn't a civil rights activist or anything like that. I didn't grow up in a time where I faced adversity such as segregation and things like that, but there's definitely hardships and stuff that I've gone through and that I have overcome. So I thought about a couple of different things to speak about. I thought about just highlighting some heroes, Black history heroes from that you may see in documentaries and textbooks and things like that. That may work a different way. I thought about talking about Booker T. Washington, a man who was born a slave, taught himself how to read, write, and ended up opening up a school and taught other African Americans to read, write, as well as trade skills so that they could provide work and provide for themselves. But I decided against doing that. I thought about talking about Harriet Tubman, and a woman who was born a slave who dedicated and risked her life to the betterment and the freedom of her own people. But I decided against that as well. I decided to talk about someone who's a little more important, a little more relevant, and that person is, well, me. But in all seriousness, by me, I mean a black man who also happens to be an educator. By me, I mean a person who cares about you guys in this audience, cares about the people, and cares about you guys growing up and being able to do whatever you want to do once you finish up high school. By me, I mean the people that I represent. So all the educators that you see in this building, though, I want to speak for them because the goal is the same. They may not look like you, they may not be African American themselves, but they're here to shape your history. They're doing things to set you up to be successful in your future and have you do whatever you want to do once you graduate, eventually high school. So I figured the best place for me to start with this whole thing would be middle school. Again, I'm gonna talk about my own story and some of the things that I went through. So in middle school, going there, I was a star student in the elementary school. And going into there's a magnet program that I was trying to get into. The magnet program was called law. And to get into that program, there was an audition process. So you had to interview, looked at your test scores, looked at your grades, teacher recommendations, the whole bit. And once you did that, they took all the stuff into account and decided if you were accepted into this magnet program. And me and all of my friends all applied to be. And once the results came in, the results come in over the summertime, so this is right before you start your sixth grade year, the results come in and they come in through the mail. And we decided to call each other all on the house phone and connect on basically with five people on one phone call. So it took a little bit of time to get it done. But our plan was to count down from three and open up all of our letters at the same time. So we counted down 3, 2, 1. And you can hear everybody open up their letters and celebrating that they got in. I'm mentioning real names here because these are real people. Jordan, Caleb, Evan, Dean, these are all guys who I grew up all got into the program. I can hear them celebrating in the background. The difference is I opened up my letter, and my letter says denied. So I did not get into the program. And the way that the program is set up is it is a school within a school, meaning that if you think about Gettys Middle School as an example, we all went to the same middle school, except for if you were in the magnet program, you were in a separate part of the building, you had separate teachers, classes, you even had separate lunches. So if you weren't in the program, you would then did not have the opportunity to know or pretty much hang out with anybody who was in the program. So not only was I not accepted, but I was also separated from my friends, meaning that they were all together, but I was separated from them. So you can imagine how this may have made me feel going into middle school, how I felt being denied from this program. Well, it was clear to me, it showed me that the people who were in charge of deciding who gets in that program were wrong. They were mistaken. There's no way they could deny me entrance. I'm a star student. How did I not get accepted into this program? So I used this as motivation. I said that going into sixth grade, I'm going to show them what they missed out on. I'm going to show them that I was capable of being in the program and I should have been there all along. So being in this, going into sixth grade, I met the first Black History hero who I want to highlight. Her name is Miss Danner. Not only is she a Black History hero, she's also the first African-American teacher who I ever had at that point in time in my educational career. And I told her my goals. I looked at her and said that, my goal is to be a part of this magnet program next year. I'm only going to be in this type of education for 1 year, and I'm out of here. I told her that I'm going to get my test scores up, my grades up, work on my interview skills, and I'm going to be in that magnet program. I told her that, and she ran with it. She determined that she was going to help me get into that magnet program that I was so desperately trying to be a part of. But she helped me in my grades, helped me get my scores up, practice my interview skills so that I would be ready to interview, be prepared for that next year. So the end of sixth grade comes around, it's time to interview. This time I'm doing things differently. I'm dressed for success. I'm wearing a collared shirt, tie, and everything like that, because the first time I interviewed, I just wore whatever I wanted, and I said, surely that is the reason why I didn't get in. But I interviewed, everything went smooth. Going into the summertime, it's result time again. Remember last time I said I called all my friends up, opened the letter, and then got my results, and got denied. Well, everyone got in. They all got accepted. But this time I was humbled by that experience, and I decided I want to open up my letter in private. I want to do things a little bit differently. And I go, no countdown, anything like that, just go in my room, open up the letter. And just as soon as I look at the letter and see the result, I knew that God, someone was looking out for me. Because this time, when the letter said denied, I could cry in private. My friends didn't have to hear me crying and sniffing over the phone when I didn't get in to the program. Now, I told you how last time going to sixth grade, I was motivated by this result. You know, I didn't get in, and I was going to prove why I deserved to be a part of that program. But this time it was different. I lashed out in school. I decided that school may have been my enemy. It wasn't here to work out for me. I thought maybe the people who worked in school didn't like me. And I was never going to be a successful student. And what I was going to do after high school, after finishing school, was up in the air at that point in time. Behavior wasn't where it needed to be all the way. And this did earn me into a program, but it wasn't a magnet program. It was an all-boys program, but you know, guys who were acting like me, guys whose grades may have suffered, guys who may have been a little bit of a behavior problem in the classroom, guys who felt that education and the education system may not be for them. And that led me to the second Black History hero who I wanted to highlight by the name of Ms. Rhodes. Ms. Rhodes, this is a math teacher specifically, but she was strict. And when I mean strict. She didn't play any games, didn't take any excuses, and behavior problems wasn't an option. You didn't have the opportunity to misbehave in her class because she shut it down immediately. But you also didn't work. When there was no time for games, you had nothing to do but get your work done and get it turned in on time. And though she was strict, I thought that she was particularly strict on me. I thought she was harder on me than everybody else. I thought she was singling me out. That maybe she may have been targeting me or something like that. I thought she felt I just didn't like me. And the line I always like to say was, everybody else is doing it, but why are you getting on me? I feel like you're all spitting on me, but everyone's doing the same thing. And she was saying the same thing to me all the time, which is, well, Cameron, why are you doing something that you weren't supposed to be doing? Why are you doing something that is wrong? And my answer would be yes. And she said, it does not matter what everybody else is doing. You need to do what you're supposed to be doing. If you are following the rules, following expectations, then you're not going to find yourself in trouble. I didn't want to hear that at the time, but that meant something to me. And we get to the end of my seventh grade year, and she lets me know that she was hard on me for a reason. She was hard on me because she knew that I was bigger than my situation at that point in time. She mentioned that she saw a little bit of herself in me. Now, that didn't mean anything to me. My behavior may have changed a little bit, but I thought she was just saying words because that's what she said to everybody. And she may have. You know, that's the type of woman that she was, but she probably told all the people, all of her students, the same thing because she meant it. But yeah, I did the same thing. I applied in eighth grade, didn't get in. But you know, that's besides the point. The point is that there was someone poured into me. So skipping eighth grade for the sake of time, but I did want to highlight some other heroes who I met in middle school. Ms. Ortiz, she was my band director. Coach Burdell, he was my soccer coach. These people aren't African American, but they're sure as heck heroes to me. They poured into me, and they showed me skills that I could not learn in the classroom. They gave me skills and extracurricular opportunities to show leadership, you know, outside of the classroom. So that was a motivating factor for me. I mean, it benefited me because going into high school, I finally got into a magnet program. It was kind of an extension from the middle school one. This one was called Exploration. It was a math and science magnet program. And going into high school, it was time for me to pick my career, figure out what I want to do when I finish high school. And at that point in time, I knew one thing and one thing only, which was I want to help people. I want to make a living by helping people in some way. And I thought the best way for me to do that was to be a doctor. You know, when I saw someone who was treated in ailments or I had a sports injury, they were being able to help me with that. I thought that was what I wanted to do. To make a living by helping people, I was going to become a doctor. I'm in a math and science magnet program. It's going to set me up perfectly. So we're fast forwarding through high school, and everything's going the way it's supposed to go. I'm a standout athlete. I'm in the magnet program that I wanted to be in. Everything's going the way I wanted to go. Except for I left out some other parts. I left out the part where I was dropped from the magnet program that I worked so hard to be in, because my grades in math and science were too low. You had to keep a certain grade in those classes to stay in the program. I left out the part where I made the soccer team and was removed from the soccer team. I left out the part where my GPA was so low that it was eye level with the doggone hands. It was bad. You know, these things all sound negative because they were. At least on their own, they were. But what I learned was each one of these things that were setbacks ended up being a setup for something that was positive in my life. I mentioned I was dropped from the magnet program that I worked again. Well, I realized, that set me up to realize that, you know, being in the medical field was not for me. Not that I didn't have the skill to do so, but I didn't have the passion for it. It wasn't something that I wanted to do and invest myself in. So I was removed from the program and I found a new avenue. The soccer team. I had a coach by the name of Coach Jones. He's a Hall of Fame, a National Hall of Fame track coach. He was also my PE teacher. He saw me running the gym and went to the soccer coach and pretty much said that, you know, if he is not going to be a varsity athlete his freshman year, cut him from the team and send him to track, which I hated at that point in time. But that meant something to me because what happened was it turned me from what would have been an average or maybe a slightly above average soccer player to someone who ended up being a D1 athlete in the sport of track and field and being able to run at USC Upstate and continue being an athlete after high school. You know, my grades fixed themselves through maturity. I knew that if I wanted to compete on a collegiate level, that I had to have grades. You know, coaches look at your grades and behavior and things like that and see what type of athlete that they want on their team. So that stuff kind of fixed itself. But all those negatives turned itself into a positive. There's still a couple issues though. I don't know what I want to do after I finish high school. At this point in time, what I want to do when I finish college. I knew I wanted to help people. I knew I wanted to make a living helping people. I just had to figure out how I was going to do it. So I thought for me, I need to follow in my dad's footsteps and go into finance, do something in business. I was going to help people get their money. That's what I thought I was going to do. I thought I was going to go be a financial advisor or something like that. Well, clearly I'm not doing that, so that's not how things panned out. But I bring that up for one reason. That leads me to my third Black History hero who I want to highlight. Her name is Ms. Wells. She taught me entrepreneurship. I was successful in her class, you know, no failing grades. In fact, I did outstanding in that class to the point where I was able to finish early and have conversations that weren't school related. And I remember being in her class, she left me with a quote. Nothing profound, nothing that you would see in a book or anything like that, but it meant something to me. She said that, Cameron, I don't know what it is that you're going to do in life, but you're going to be successful at. And all that showed me was this. There was someone who was out there who believed in me, and not to say I can just give you empty words, but you know, knew that I could be successful at something. And I think all along she knew that business and entrepreneurship may not have been where my passion was, but she saw something in me and knew that I could be successful at something. So things are going well. Those words stuck with me. I'm at the point where I'm accepted to USC Upstate as an academic. You know, I've gotten on the academic side, but I wasn't able to run at that point in time. Coach Jones, the Hall of Famer who I mentioned before, knew I was going there and reached out to that track coach and spoke of my work ethic, spoke of my ability, and got me the opportunity to run on the next level just based off of his reputation around the state alone. Again, he's another man who's not an African-American, but a hero of me. Without him, I wouldn't have been able to compete on the collegiate level and all the doors and leadership opportunities that opened up for me. So I'm eternally grateful for those things. So now I'm in college, at least I'm accepted to college. I'm able to run track and field. The only thing left for me to figure out is what I want to major in. Basically, what am I going to do? What classes am I going to take to set me up for a career? And, you know, I went to the only person who I knew give me the answer. That was my mom. And she said something that was simple, but it made a lot of sense. She said that if you could do anything in life, and it didn't matter what it paid or if it paid at all, what would it be? And that's when I realized what I knew the entire time was, you know, I wanted to be an educator. I wanted to be a teacher. I wanted to be in that field because everybody who had the biggest impact on my life, people who helped me more than anybody who I've ever come in contact with, have all been an educator. Whether they've been a teacher, a coach, band director, administrator, etc. All these people shaped me to be who I am today. So it led me to where I could be in a position where I can make a living by helping people. So here's the cool part. I mentioned three different Black History heroes. I mentioned Miss Danner, I mentioned Miss Rose, and I mentioned Miss Wells. Miss Danner was my sixth grade teacher. She's now an administrator, assistant principal at Blythewood High School. These are real people, real places. You can look it up. She's an assistant principal at Blythewood High School, and she's responsible for helping 2,000 kids every single day, and then however many middle schoolers enroll in next year. She's getting paid, she's making a living to help 2,000 kids every single day. The second hero I mentioned was Ms. Rose, my seventh grade teacher. She is now an assistant principal administrator at Richmond Northeast High School in Columbia, helping 1,400 kids every single day, getting paid, making a living to help as many people as possible. Ms. Wells, my entrepreneurship teacher. She's now assistant principal at Spring Valley High School, able to help 2,000 kids every single day. They all made me who I am today. Cameron Pratt, assistant principal at Easley High School, able to help 1,900 kids, and now the 1,000 plus kids that go here to Geddes Middle School on a daily basis. Now, these people poured into me and helped me get to where I want to go. So when they say they believe me, or they saw something in me, I had to believe it. No, I'm living proof that, no, it didn't matter where I started, that belief in me, them pouring into me, helped me get to where I am today, to where I can finally help people. I can finally make a living by helping as many people as possible. So what does this have to do with Black history? And I think it means everything. I think it means that everybody who I mentioned today is still alive. They're not from a story, not from a documentary. There are people who I can call on, reach out to on social media to this day, and ask for help. And that's where I want to be for you guys. Someone who you know, someone you can reference to help you out and mold your history. These people have molded my spot in Black history and my own life, which is important. You guys can do the same. Every educator you see in this building who is doing something for you, or being tough on you, or pouring into you, all that is making history. If you're an African American, they're molding your spot in African American history by pouring into you. So if someone's being tough on you, know that it's oftentimes from a place of love. But you don't have to be an educator. You don't have to be paid to make a living by helping people. You can do that right now as a student at Geddes Middle School. So if you see someone who's down on themselves, and use that as an opportunity to help them. If you are a strong friend or something like that, and you are going through hardship, so don't use that as an opportunity to give up. No, look at those opportunities as, hey, what I'm going through is setting me up to do something better. This setback is going to be a setup that I'm prepared to do something here in the future. And maybe I can share my experience with meeting you, whatever experience you're going through, you can share that to be able to help somebody else in the future. So I challenge y'all with this. You know, leave here, find a way to help somebody, find a way to help and improve your own life. Be the hero. Find your way to be a Black history hero and help somebody else. Thank you, guys.
January 20th, 2012, was a popular American rhythm and blues singer and entertainer.
who in time became a successful ballad singer. She was known for her hit songs. Etta James released numerous hit songs throughout her career, including At Last, I'd Rather Go Blind, and Tell Mama. Her powerful vocals and emotional delivery resonated with audiences worldwide. She was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1993. Etta James was honored with induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. The recognition solidified her status as a music legend and celebrated her contribution to the industry. She had a successful acting career. Etta James showcased talents beyond music and pursued an acting career. She appeared in films such as Cadillac Records and 20 Bucks, further displayed her versatility as an entertainer. She received the Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award in 2003. Etta James was honored with the Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award for her contribution to the music industry.
Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed faculty, and our incredible students, it's my great pleasure to introduce today's guest speaker, Mr. CJ Davidson. A homegrown talent, CJ is a proud 2011 graduate from Daniel High School, where he left an indelible mark as two-sport athlete in football and track and field. CJ continued his academic and athlete journey at Clemson University, where he not only excelled on the field, but also embraced the spirit of learning and personal growth. What set CJ apart from his steadfast commitment and philosophy, trust the process. This mantra has guided him through challenges, victories, and continuous journey of self-improvement. In 2016, CJ Davidson took a bold step forward founding Temple Sports Academy, TSA, recognizing the divine timing in every individual's life. CJ envisioned a space where youth could understand what their tempo is, that their tempo, whether fast or slow, is always right on time. This vision reflects that not just understanding of sports, but a broader commitment in impacting the lives of young individuals academically, athletically, and spiritually. CJ has cultivated the culture of TSA that goes beyond the field, instilling values and principles and extends into the core of each student athlete. His dedication to continue learning, sharing valuable resources, and investing in professional development speaks volumes about his commitment to propelling young athletes to success. Please join me in welcoming a true role model, motivator, and community leader, Mr. CJ Davidson, to say his insight.
If you got your head down, do me a favor, pick your head up for me. Matter of fact, everybody just go ahead and stand up again. I had the first group stand up. Get the guy to come up. I was the same type of athlete who let things kind of go by the wayside. I didn't care about what people were saying. You know, we had great speakers that come in and speak to us when I was coming through middle school. Sometimes I was the one who had my head down, and I was the same one who had my head down when I went through failures and I didn't know how to cope with it. Okay, so I want you guys to think about that as I'm speaking. All right, I hate to bring that energy in here like that, but that's what needs to be done. Okay. Just to kind of reiterate again who I am, I'm CJ Davidson. I'm proud to say that. I'm proud of the things that I've accomplished in my 31 years. I know that probably sounds super old to you guys, but I'm really not. I'm really not old. I've done a lot in my career. I came through Seneca, the Seneca sports scene, Seneca district, and I eventually transferred into the Pickens County, went to Daniel High School, where I finished my high school career. And I joked about this with the last group, but I always try to show gratitude to people that gave me a lot of confidence through my career, whether it was teachers, coaches, teams, and you know, I joked about this, but you know, Easley High School, Easley Geddes Middle School, you guys have also been a part of my success in that I have never lost a game to any Easley team. So y'all clap it up for yourself. Any guys play basketball in here? Okay, cool. So I was at the Seneca game when you guys lost, but there you go. Look, you guys are some good athletes, all right? So I'm just doing things just to kind of have a little icebreaker. You guys play phenomenal. I want to tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up playing various sports, all kind of sports that you can think of. I ran track, I played football, I played basketball, all these things I enjoyed doing. I always was looking at people and things to be able to help me become a better person, a better athlete. I ended up going to high school with track and field being my primary sport. I then earned a scholarship to go run track at Clemson University. Going into Clemson University, I was one of the top five track athletes in the nation. And I hold my head high to that because I put a lot of work in. Once I got to Clemson University, I only ran track for 1 year before I decided that, hey, look, this is not really what I'm truly passionate about anymore. So I dropped my scholarship and I walked on to the football team where I earned a scholarship and eventually a starting spot. These things are what helped make me, because I also went through a lot of adverse times along with a lot of success. After I finished at Clemson, I went on to play a little bit of ball in the CFL in Canada. That experience was it was good. It allowed me to go and learn a lot about some parts of the world that I have never been around, and it, you know, gave me a different perspective on things. Once I got back from doing that, I came and I hit the ground running. I started Tempo Sports Academy. Some of you guys may know who we are. Some of you guys, females, may have played volleyball against some of our teams. Some of you guys may play ball against some of our basketball teams or ran track against some of our athletes. Started Tempo Sports Academy, and I'm also the owner of Momentarily Collection Media, where we have photography and also videography for the upstate. I've done a lot. I've been able to do a lot, had a lot of successes. I've been able to see the world. I have a lot of wisdom in my small 31 years, and I'm here to share that with you guys. But I can't try to take all the credit for that. There are so many people, there's so many things that helped me and molded me to become the person that I am. So when Mr. Hall asked me to come speak, I wasn't hesitant. I just wasn't sure about what I was going to speak about. And I wanted to be able to allow it to be something that you guys can really relate to and retain. When I was younger, I had all these different figures in my life who I kind of like handpicked that I wanted to be like. The first person I want to talk about, and again, I may be showing my age with this, but how many of you guys know Allen Iverson?
We do.
You know AI, right? Okay, AI. So Allen Iverson was, he was everything to me, man. I wanted to be just like AI. One thing that stuck out to me about Allen Iverson was the fact that, you know, he didn't look like everybody else. He didn't wear suits to the Coliseum to come play ball. He wasn't as clean cut as some of the guys. Allen Iverson had tattoos on his neck, on his arms, sleeve was sleeved up. He had braids. He wore a headband. I wanted to be just like AI. I wanted to be able to look like that while playing ball. I didn't have any tattoos. I still don't. But I went and got a headband. I had braids. I wore braids and headband every day of school from like third to fifth grade. I did that. I wanted to be AI. This guy had a major impact on my life, and subconsciously, I didn't really know why I liked what he was doing. Yes, he was a great ball player, but it was so much more than that. The next person I'm going to talk about, and this may be before your time, some of you guys may respect this athlete, but Michael Vick. Do you guys know who Michael Vick is? Raise your hand if you know who Michael Vick is. Yeah, see? Right there. If it was early 2000s, this auditorium would be lit up. Michael Vick was the first black quarterback to go and get drafted number one overall in the NFL draft. He went on to set all kind of rushing records from the quarterback position. He was just a culture phenomenon as well. He did things that were never seen before from the quarterback position, from the way he was juking people out, from the way he held the ball. I wanted to be just like Michael Vick. That was one of my idols. I wanted to be able to shift the culture. I wanted to be able to change the game, change the way the game was played. So I played quarterback when I was younger. I wanted to be able to do things and be able to be respected enough to be able to be unstoppable. Anybody play Madden? Got anybody play Madden on here? Yeah, okay. So in 2004, they continued to extend the series of Madden in 2004. Michael Vick was on the cover. I was one of the first ones. We had to wait in line. Before you just download, you had to wait in line. I waited in line in 2004 and got that game on PS2. And I played it so much, man. And the first person I played with was the Falcons, Michael Vick. If anybody knows about this game, if anybody is within this era, within my age bracket, you understand that Michael Vick was unstoppable on this game. Completely unstoppable. You could do anything you wanted to. And that right there it set the tone for what I wanted to be, who I wanted people to see me as, how I wanted to be perceived. How can I be just like that to where he literally is changing the game on the game? The next person and the last person I want to kind of highlight is my dad. My dad has been so influential in my life that, I can't help but highlight the things he's done. My dad was somebody in the community who was able to be well respected. He was able to make people laugh. He still is to this day. He was a great community leader. He had basketball teams. He was an entrepreneur. I had a lot of time to spend with my dad because he was always at home. He had his own schedule. I love these things about him. But the most important thing I love was that he was my dad. So, you know, I talk about these three people and as an adult now with a little more wisdom, I kind of sit back and I peel the layers all the way back and say, why was it that I loved Allen Iverson? What was it about him that made me so intrigued and made me so gravitate towards him? The thing I liked about Allen Iverson was that he was able to do things his way. He was able to come in into an arena that most of the guys didn't look like him. The face of the NBA from the prior time did not look like him. But he made his service greater than his perception. He made what he did better than his perception. And remember that. And so, you know, as a kid, you don't realize why you gravitate towards people, why you do the things you do, why you pick certain people to be your role model. You don't understand that. And I didn't at the time, but now I do. When I think about Michael Vick, I think about being a game changer. I think about why I literally wanted to do everything he did by even holding the ball when I was running the same way. I wanted to break records. I ran track and I played football at Clemson, not a lot of athletes do that. I broke my own records. I wanted to go and do things that hadn't been done before, the same way that Vick done. And though I wasn't, at the time, I wasn't really a true Michael Vick fan at the time, had kind of outgrown that, these things were embedded inside of me. They were embedded into me. Meaning that once it was instilled in me that I wanted to be like that, it never left. My dad, I seen him fight through so many different things. I seen him be able to face adversity, adverse times, and be able to get in and out of it and be successful on the back end. When I got to Clemson, I didn't have immediate success. When I was on the track team, I did all right. When I was on the football team, I started back at ground zero. This is when right before we started going into all our bowl games and started the Chick-fil-A Bowl all the way to the national championship. I had to work my way to a point to where I was able to play, let alone start. I had to fight to be able to make these things happen. These things came from my dad. Subconsciously, he taught me how to do these things. And while I'm younger, I don't realize what's actually happening. I don't realize that, yes, he's the reason why I'm fighting. He's the reason why I kept going. He's the reason why things may look murky, but I go on, I come out on top. So, you know, all in all, what I was able to gain was I became a new person throughout this process. You guys have an opportunity right now. You are following tons of people on Instagram. You guys are following tons of people. You're watching tons of people on whatever it is, Netflix, Hulu, whatever outlet you have. You guys are constantly watching people, and you're soaking in the knowledge. There are some people that you follow subconsciously. You don't even realize you're doing it. Your algorithm is probably putting it into your phone all the time. There's a reason why you like to follow that person. There's a reason why you like to view who that is. And so once you get to a point to where you can actually peel the layers back the way I did, you'll understand what those reasons are. In my pursuit to become Allen Iverson, Michael Vick, or my dad, I became my own person. I never made it to the NBA. As much as I wanted to be like him, I never made it to the NBA. I never made it to the NFL. But I did a lot of other stuff. And I'm very proud of it. So when I look at when I started my business, Tempo Sports Academy, all of these things, all of these attributes that I've gained, all of these things that I gained from these people, they helped me in my career to this day. Why are we the only sports organization in South Carolina with all four sports? I don't know. I just was put my head down and worked. The Michael Vick effect was embedded into me. Just work, break records, be a game changer, do things that nobody has ever done. I stepped into an arena that most of the people didn't look like me, and they still don't. And I like that. The AI effect is still embedded into me. I walk in here, and I want you guys to understand what I'm saying. When I'm in the gym and I'm working with people, I wear my earrings. I wear my chains, I wear whatever I feel comfortable in. Because I feel like that it doesn't matter what room I'm in, I can articulate my message, I can speak with confidence, and that's what matters most. Because just like AI, my service was greater than my perception. You guys gotta understand that there's so many things that you guys are gonna go through in life. Black history is all around us. If it's before us, it is history. History is happening right now as we speak. In my pursuit to be these people, I became my own person. I became the confident person that you see today. I haven't always been like this. But hopefully what I'm saying today is gonna be able to ignite something in you. You may not wanna be like me. You may not wanna be like any of your teachers. But you're gonna be just like somebody that you're following, that you look up to. And you're gonna have all the intangibles that they'll have. And you're gonna look back and you're gonna appreciate who that is, whether it's black history or just history in general. But I wanted to highlight those three people because they helped shape me and helped make me who I am today. So I'm gonna leave you guys with this before we go. In your pursuit to be the person that you're following right now, you're gonna break your own barriers. You're gonna knock down your own walls. You're gonna gain your own confidence. But realize that you may fall short of being that person, or you may go far, far more than what they ever do. At the end of the day, you become your own history, black history or not. I appreciate you guys. Thank you.
Bryson was born on April 13, 1951 in Greenville, South Carolina. He is an actor and a composer known for Aladdin, Beauty and the Beast, and Friday After Next. Peabo Bryson was a renowned Grammy Award-winning artist known for his incredible vocal range and soulful performance. With a career spanning of several decades, he has competitive captivated audience worldwide with smooth R&B and hip-hop ballads. Peebo Bryson is best known for his collaboration with Disney on some of their iconic soundtracks. He lent his powerful vocals to hit songs like A Whole New World from Adeline and Beauty and the Beast, with Celine Dion which both won Grammy Awards. Peebo Bryson has enjoyed a successful solo career with chart-topping hits like If Ever You're in My Arms and Tonight I Collaborate My Love with Roberta Flack. His soulful voice is heartfelt, and heartfelt lyrics have made him a favorite among fans across the globe. Peebo Bryson has showcased his versatility and artist by venturing into virgin music genres from R&B and soul, pop, and jazz. He has seamlessly navigated through different styles, showcasing his exponential talent and adaptability. Peebo Bryson has contributed his powerful vocals to theme songs for TV shows and movies. His rendition of Can You Stop the Rain served as a theme song for popular TV shows Beverly Hills and 90210, farther solidifying his status as a versatile artist.
Students, welcome. We're going to be singing you a song called I Know Where I've Been. Make sure you're respectful. These students have worked a hard time playing this song for you. We hope you enjoy.
There's a light in my darkness. road we must travel, y'all. There is a promise that we must make. Oh, but the riches will be plenty. Work the risk and the chances.
Upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I think I've got the diamonds at the meeting of my mind? Out of the huts of history, shame, I rise. Up from the past, with rooted in pain, I rise. From the black ocean, leaping and wide, swelling and welling, I bear the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise.
All right, eighth grade, thank you for being wonderful guests. But before we leave, we gotta make sure that we show gratitude to everybody that helped to make this program to be a success. So let's give a round of applause to our orchestra. A round of applause to all of our choir students and our soloists. calls to the teachers or exposure teachers that are supervising some of the prep work, that are supervising the work. And the biggest of all to our guest speakers, Mr. Pratt and Mr. Bateson, and that gives them a huge round of applause. So Mr. Pratt, as one of your speakers, is super important because as you guys are transitioning to high school next year, like he said, that is a face that you need to find, right? He's already gonna be an administrator. He's gonna have a certain section of the alphabet, but if you need somebody that's gonna pour into you, give you that encouragement, that's somebody. And if you're an athlete, Mr. Davidson is another well-known upstate savant that's gonna be here to support you, all right? So again, as you leave this Black History Month program, keep Black History Month and just history in general in your minds and in your hearts. And when you face adversity, when you face times of uncertainty or you're trying to figure out, you're stressed out about all the day-to-days that is middle school, remember that that too shall pass and you'll overcome that as well. All right, so we're about to get ready to dismiss. We're going to start with our classes in the back first. So our